Hi, let's talk about the bronchial tree. In this video, we'll discuss the bronchial tree, we'll discuss its histology and how its histology changes according to the region of the tree. We'll also discuss what happens to the bronchial tree during a sympathetic response, and we'll talk about the bronchopulmonary segments. So the bronchial tree requires very little imagination to understand how it gets its name. So if you were to take that image and rotate it 180 degrees, you would see, you know, there's a trunk, some branches, some other branches on those branches, some foliage, etc. So this is most definitely an inverted tree-like pathway. So the majority of the bronchial tree is conductive. So the story of the, let's just call it the purely conductive portion of the respiratory pathway that isn't shared by the digestive system, begins in the larynx. So the larynx is contiguous with the laryngopharynx, and it's there at the laryngopharynx that there's a decision made whether materials are heading towards the respiratory system or the digestive system. So if respiratory, then materials move through the larynx, or colloquially the voice box, and then that larynx articulates with the trachea. So the trachea there is the trunk of the bronchial tree, and we can see that it is comprised of numerous, so generally about 13 C-shaped hyaline cartilage. So it's incomplete in the posterior. There's a little bit of smooth musculature there in the trachealis. And then the trachea is going to bifurcate into the primary bronchi. So the primary bronchi, or the main stem bronchi, are the right and the left. The right tends to be a little larger and a little more vertically oriented, whereas the left tends to be a little smaller in diameter and a little more obliquely oriented. Those primary bronchi are then going to divide into secondary bronchi. And the secondary bronchi are what are known as the lobar bronchi. Because these secondary bronchi serve lobes of the lung. It's probably important to understand or to recall that the right lung typically has three lobes, whereas the left lung typically has two lobes. And so the right lung will have three secondary bronchi, the left lung will have two secondary bronchi. Multifurcating off of these secondary bronchi are the tertiary bronchi, also known as segmental bronchi, because they are what feed into bronchopulmonary segments, which we'll discuss shortly. So if we look at this endocast of a bronchial tree here, I want you to keep in mind that this is a posterior view. So there's the trachea. Here are the main stem bronchi. So this is going to be left and this is going to be right. So it's different than what was above here with right and left. We can see there's one, two, three, and four secondary bronchi. And then we can see all of the tertiary bronchi coming off of those secondary bronchi. Now, from the tertiary bronchi arise the bronchioles. And the bronchioles are going to be a sequentially diminishing in diameter pathway of airway. The first part of the bronchioles are the conducting bronchioles, and these quickly are going to divide into terminal bronchioles. The terminal bronchioles are named that because they are the terminus of the conducting zone. So everything beyond the terminal bronchioles is going to be in the respiratory zone. Whereas anything at that level and proximal will be in the conducting zone. Now, as we move through the bronchioles, we're going to notice that histologically, the amount of hyaline cartilage embedded in the walls of these pathways is going to diminish, and the amount of smooth muscle is going to increase. And so as we move through the bronchioles, the autonomic nervous system is going to be so much more important with respect to regulating the diameter of the airway. Now, within that last part of the conducting zone, that terminal bronchioles area, we have numerous club cells. Club cells are amazing. They do a lot for the respiratory system. So they're protective. They contain enzymes that can break down pathogens and other foreign bodies. They produce surfactant or a surfactant-like substance that helps to maintain the patency of the airway. They could even they have microvilli on them, so they are in and amongst the ciliated epithelium. So they can help move mucus, and they can mitotically divide to produce more club cells to replace some of that epithelium along the pathway. Now, what's interesting about these club cells, it's sort of a two-edged sword, is that they have an enzyme that can actually cleave a surface protein, so hemagglutinin, from influenza virus, and that actually activates the influenza virus. And so these club cells, whereas they're very protective, they are what actually will activate the flu virus in the conductive pathway of the lung. So there's that. Most wonderful things in life carry with them taxes, and that's not too big a burden. And so coming off of the terminal bronchioles are the respiratory bronchioles. The respiratory bronchioles are largely just smooth muscle. During a sympathetic response, smooth muscle is going to relax. And so the respiratory pathway is going to dilate. And that's going to allow for better ventilation. Now, this is also good to know, because if a person has some sort of food allergy or is in danger of anaphylaxis, you can administer epinephrine, and epinephrine is then going to work on that same smooth muscle within the bronchioles to dilate it and to relax it to ward off anaphylaxis, which is, important for staying alive. Now, those tertiary bronchioles, tertiary bronchi or segmental bronchi, serve bronchopulmonary segments. And so here we can see the trachea dividing into the primary bronchi, and then into the secondary bronchi. And then everything that's colored here, other than, this blue color, is a tertiary bronchus. And each tertiary bronchus corresponds to these bronchopulmonary segments. So for instance, one here and one there is going to correspond to the apical or the apico-posterior segments of the lung. So two there to the posterior segment of the superior lobe, three, the anterior segment of the superior lobe, four and five to the medial lobe, six, this is kind of an important one, we'll come back to this, to the superior segment of the inferior lobe, and then, everything else to the inferior lobe. So you see a little bit of variation between left and right lungs, keeping in mind that the right lung is going to have three lobes to it, a superior, a middle, and an inferior, whereas the left lung simply has superior and inferior lobes. So this is going to somewhat affect the distribution of bronchopulmonary segments ever so slightly. But I do want to draw your attention to these superior segments of the inferior lobe. So you can see just a little bit of it there, there, and there. The superior segments of the inferior lobes are going to be important because their tertiary bronchi are posteriorly oriented. And this is very unique amongst all of the tertiary bronchi because they're the only ones that go posteriorly. And what this means is that for a person who is confined to their bed long term, so they're not elevated at all, they're not up and moving around, fluid can accumulate in this superior segment of the inferior lobe. So that is a risk for pneumonia, and that can be very problematic in terms of long-term prognosis. So that leads us to our assessment question for the video, and that is, bronchopulmonary segments are directly and completely served by which elements of the bronchial tree? Bronchioles, primary bronchi, secondary bronchi, or tertiary bronchi? Well, bronchopulmonary segments are supplied by segmental bronchi. Those are tertiary bronchi. Correct answer is D. Secondary bronchi, those serve lobes. Primary bronchi serve lungs. Thank you very much for your time.